Dear learners, welcome to the course on geothermal energy. This is the 9th lecture in the series of renewable energy or non-conventional energy sources. Myself, Arpan Deyashi, from the Department of Electronics and Communication Engineering of RCC Institute of Information Technology, India, welcome you all to the lecture series on renewable energy systems. Today, we will discuss about the geothermal energy. I think from the name, you can very easily find out that it is related with the earth because of the term geo, and also thermal means somewhere it is related with the higher temperature. So, just a intrinsic investigation or a some sort of intuition helps us to understand that it is the energy which is below the earth's surface and we are thinking about extracting it for the benefit of civilization. So if we slightly look out to the more details, then geothermal energy is nothing but defined as the heat energy inside the earth's surface and generated by various natural sort of processes. Now the question at this point may be focused on what are the natural processes by which geothermal energy can be generated. So the first point is obviously the radioactive materials. What are the radioactive materials and how they will give us the geothermal energy? I think from the school level, when we have learned about Mendeleev's periodic table, we know what are the radioactive materials and they naturally start always decaying. So because of their decay, the huge amount of energy that is emitted or exerted by those materials, those are confined in the different layers inside the earth surface. So if I dig into the earth surface and go to a particular location, then that amount of energy can be availed and can be extracted through proper means. So radioactive elements, which are generally available in different internal layers of the earth, can cause a major source of geothermal energy. The second point we can very easily discuss about the residual heat. Now, from the concept of Big Bang theory, when the earth starts to generate and days after day the outer layer of the earth becomes cool so that it helps to form the living beings in different varieties, but the inner layers of the earth doesn't get cooler at the same rate. So if I go inside the earth's surface, we will find that the temperature will be much higher. So that temperature gives, that means it will get a huge sort of heat. So that heat can be extracted in the form of meaningful resources, and we can rotate the turbines or we can get the required amount of energy. So the residual heat, which is available in the different layers inside the earth's surface, and also give us geothermal energy. And the third source, which is not in generally happened in a periodical manner, but it is a type of source also which is very important, is called the meteorite impact. Now meteorite is not normally caused a very large time gap. The duration will be very, very large for between the two consecutive meteorite events. But once a meteorite impacted on the earth's surface, it generally goes deeper of the earth layer because of the large velocity it comes. And that's why the amount of energy is embedded inside some layers of the earth's surface. So that energy can also be extracted and can also be considered as a type of the geothermal energy available. So once we know these forms, So how it will get the manifestation of the geothermal energy in the different form of volcano, the hot springs, the building, the mud pots, and the geyser. You can search in Google. There is a huge source of geothermal energy in the earth called geyser. So these things are available, and we can obviously, the terminology volcano is known to all, and we will know that how huge amount of energy can be extracted from the earth's surface, and it can destroy the other natural living beings which are very closely associated or in the path of the movement of the lava or magma. So this is one of the great examples of the geothermal energy, and we have familiar from our geography textbook from the school level. And these different forms of the geothermal energy can be extracted by proper design of the geothermal power plant. In the figure below, you will get a geothermal power plant, and it requires a huge amount of area for proper extraction of this energy. So in the next section, I will discuss how the geothermal power plant works in a detailed brief manner, and also I will discuss the major features of different geothermal power plants, and also I will discuss the functionalities of the geothermal power plant, that means the components of different geothermal power plants and its functionalities. So these are the major points which I will discuss in the next part of this course. So next I will move how the geothermal energy is basically obtained. So in order to get it, people dig the earth's surface as vertical as possible, because it is not perfectly possible to make a perfect vertical digging and you can insert a pipe, but the bending of the pipe should be as less as possible, and cooled water is passed through it and that goes inside the earth and naturally heated by the earth's warmth. So once the heating process is over, then heat pump is used to take the heat from the underground water and by which it is taken from, and ultimately the hot water, it comes outside and its pressure is released so that it can become steam and it can help to rotate a turbine, and that means the water will become again cooled, and that cool water is recycled or reutilized to send inside the earth surface again. So it is basically nothing but a cyclic process which I am using again and again, and I am showing you a geothermal power plant in a schematic manner. The blue vertical pipe is the direction of the injection well, that means through which the cool water is sent, and once cool water is sent inside the earth, it will become heated. The hot water is shown by the red arrow, that is the red pipe. It comes outside and its pressure is released so that it can form steam, and steam helps to rotate the turbine. From that we can get the desired amount of energy, and once steam is utilized to rotate the turbine, naturally it will be cooled up again, so cooled down, and this cooled water is again reused which goes inside the earth. So it is just a cyclic process. I am explaining in the form of a flow diagram. So my first stage is hot water is taken outside from using a pump, and when the water reaches the surface, the pressure will be dropped. So water will be turned into steam. Steam rotates the turbine. It produces the electricity. Steam cool down and using a cooling tower, and it condenses back to the water, and that cold water is pumped back to the earth to begin the process. So that is the total flow diagram. Using the previous one and this one, that is the total flow diagram of the geothermal energy extraction. So we are normally, these things are made by three different types of plants. Normally people use, those are dry plant, hot plant, and binary cycle plant. Now in some textbook, the hot steam plant can be also written as flash steam plant. So both are same. So we normally call it as dry steam, hot steam, and binary cycle. So first, let me allow to discuss the steps again what are the various features with some sort of diagram, and then I will move to the components which are mostly common to all sort of plants and what are their functionalities. So first I am moving to the diastem plant. In the right side you will get a picture. I can enlarge it for your help. You will get a picture which shows the injection well by which the cooling water or the cooled water is sent. The red portion of the earth layer, basically red means higher temperature, that's why it is colored as red. And the water is heated up, and this orange water, which is pumped up and goes to your turbines. Turbines are shown here. Those are rotated because it is converted to steam. And then it is cooled down and it is condensed and it backs to the cooling water. And along with the turbine, there are some generation facilities available. So once you know all these things, I am again coming back to the diastem plant, which is the oldest type of plant. The reservoir contains the pure diastem. The temperature varies from 150 degree to 200 degree Celsius. And there are some rock catchers required. Because you are just heating up, so some rocks can also be distracted. Now, these rocks can basically damage your mechanical infrastructure. So you require some rock catchers, which basically catches the rock coming from the underground so that it should not destroy the condensation process or the turbine or the electricity generation procedure. So that's associated with the dry steam. But it is later replaced by the hot steam plant. Why hot steam? The scenario is slightly more complex. I am showing it. With the production well, it goes to steam or brine. Some part of the waste brine again fed to the injection well, and some goes to the turbine and generates the electricity. So basically it is two parts, the brine is divided or the steam is divided. So I am showing it. So it is the containing both hot water and steam. So pressure changing system is required. The hot water again quickly cooled down and goes to the injection well, and steam rotates the turbine, condensed and added with the cooled water. So this is commonly used, and it has the segregation facility of hot water and steam. So that's why it is called hot steam plant. Next I am coming to the binary cycle plant. It is also almost close to the hot steam, but steam is not directly used to spin the turbine. That is the difference. We use a secondary liquid, which form of different sort of hydrocarbons. I am enlarging the diagram for your help. From the production well, there will be a heat exchanger. And there is a secondary liquid which takes the heat and rotates the turbine. So the primary liquid which releases the heat cools down very quickly and can go to the injection well again, and the turbine along with there is a generation facility. So steam is not directly used to rotate the turbine, and the help is you can use a secondary liquid whose temperature varies between 55 to 65 degrees centigrade, which helps to rotate the turbine. So steam heats your secondary liquid, which turns into steam, and then turbine starts to rotate, so there will be no harmful gas emission. And in the previous cases, if you think, some part of the steam is always lost. But here, loss of the steam is very much restricted because you are using a secondary liquid. So that's why binary cycle is most preferred compared to the dry steam or hot steam plant, and that is generally used all over the earth. So what are the major components of all these power plants? According to the figure, you will find out that there should be one production well and one injection well. Production well means through which the hot water comes, and injection well by which cool water going down. There should be some sort of separator required, turbine and generators required. And there should be some sort of condensator, because ultimately you have to cool down the steam. So I am displaying just what are the functionalities of different components. The production well is nothing but a geothermal vent. It is a deep well drip into the earth that the power plant uses to tap inside the earth. Its depth varies from 10 to 15 kilometers, and it is moist or generally dry steam is used. the steam generator is nothing but a flash steam vent where superheated pressurized water is drawn from its place underground to the low pressure tanks. Then pressure of the water in liquid form, it is just released in high temperature, and by removing the pressure, it converted to steam. That's why it is called flash steam. In a dry steam plant, the plant technicians pump water to the bottom of the vent where the earth seed boils the water and turns to the steam. So steam generator is a compulsory part for hot, for dry, as well as for binary cycle. But for binary cycle, remind, the steam is generated from the secondary liquid, not from the primary liquid. The turbine, it is regardless for all those cases, primary turbine is required, from geothermal vent to turbine. The steam passes the turbine, it rotates, and it is attached to an electric generator you have already found for all these three diagrams. And as the turbine turns into the generator, the mechanical energy converts to the electrical energy. So we are getting the usable amount of electricity. Next comes to the condenser. The steam passes through the turbine, it continues the condenser chamber. This basically backs the steam to the liquid water, and obviously at a very lower temperature. Then excess heat lost as the steam turns into the liquid water may be used for other sort of applications, like for heating some sort of materials or for some greenhouse farming, those cases. And the cool liquid water again typically pumped back to the ground just to restart the boiling process, or the naturally heated aquifer for flash steam plant, whatever the cases, it is basically a recycling process. Next, we are coming to the separator. It is used to remove the non-condensable gases from the steam, because steam sometimes contains the different sort of other gases, and inside the pipe, it is not possible to separate them. That means inside the production well. The injection well, it excess condensed and brine from the separator and returns back to the underground thermal reservoir. So it is nothing but same mechanism for sending the cooler water. So these are the major components of the geothermal energy. So location is very important, because you have to find out where actually the energy is available, and you have to make your mechanical infrastructure, because initial cost is very high. So we have to think about those factors also. So what are the uses? Normally the hot springs used as spa, the heating water in the fish farms, raising plants at the greenhouses, that's one of the extremely important cases, the providing heat to the industrial sectors, these are the direct uses. So it is environment friendly, renewable, has a huge potential, it is sustainable, it's stable, reliable, and no external fuel is required except for the binary cycle plant, but that is not the fuel, that is a secondary liquid, which along with the primary liquid requires to maintain the operation, but no external fuel is required. So that's one of the major advantage. But it is location restricted. You can't dig anywhere in the earth place and can get the geothermal energy. That's not possible. So the environmental side effect is a major factor, because ultimately when you are running this plant, there will be the rock catchers you require sometimes, and maybe the earth surface may be damaged. So these factors you have to consider, and extra digging may cause a several earthquake, because you are just disturbing the natural layers of the earth surface. So that may cause an earthquake, and the initial cost for setting up this operation will be very, very high. So that is another major disadvantage of the geothermal energy. But nonetheless, it is a type of renewable energy, and we have to use this as the major sources of energy. The natural energy sources are dying out. So we have to search for various options of the renewable energy. And this is one of the example of that. These are some selected web links and from some textbooks where you can consult. And that's all for today. So in the next class, we will go for the tidal energy. Thank you all.